of Locust the Opera, Professor Annie Guzzo. She teaches composition and music theater at the University of Wyoming, composes a wide range of music which is performed both nationally and internationally with instrumentations that range from solo and duet pieces to works for chamber orchestras, symphonic orchestras, and full-voiced choirs. You know, we all consider Wyoming a beautiful state, its mountains and forests, its wildlife and sunsets. We not only enjoy watching them, but we regularly photograph them, even though we live here and see it all the time. We photograph them so we can view them over and over again, you know, in those wee hours of the night when we want to, you know, double check things. Professor Guzzo, in many of her compositions, records Wyoming and the natural world not by taking pictures, but by taking sound images, by composing music that evokes the natural world here around us. Clarinets take center stage in her pieces like Rabbit's Joke, The Color of Honey, and Antelope Pavane. Did I say that? Pavane, okay. Life in the Leaves features a saxophone quartet. A choir performs her meditation, I Have Loved the Stars, and it takes a symphony orchestra to present her fanfare for mountains and peace. Annie is here today to speak to us about the composition of her latest work, Locust, the opera, which premiered last night at the National Museum of Wildlife Art. Performed by the Colorado Chamber Orchestra and three soloists, it tells the story of the Rocky Mountain locust, from its vast swarms to its demise, seeking an explanation for its disappearance. Here's Dr. Guzzo to tell us about this challenge and how she met it with a composition we heard last night.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here, and I want to thank the library, Teton County Library, the Wyoming Humanities, Saturday University, and especially the National Museum of Wildlife Art, who very generously sponsored us. I'm sure there's a zillion other people I should thank, so forgive me if I've forgotten you. Today, what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you a little bit about the opera Locust from a musical standpoint. And what I'm going to talk about is narrative, and how music, even without the words, can create narrative. And how I can layer in multiple different layers of narrative as I'm composing. And so the three narratives that I'm going to talk about, the first one is a layer of narrative that expresses relaxation or tension in music, and how that is achieved. I'm going to show you some typical opera that you might be familiar with, and how it's done by these composers of the past, and then I'll put it into context in Locust, the opera. Then the second thing is I'll lead you through a layer of narrative that is maybe slightly more hidden and tells a few more things if you're a careful listener, and if you saw it last night, maybe you come again today, I'm hoping, and see that layer in action. And then the third level is a personal level of narrative, some little personal things that I infuse the opera with, just because I was with it for so many months that, you know, you have to infuse your own personality. So here's the three layers. First, we're going to do a little, you can see I like audience participation. We're going to do a little quiz here. And on a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being really, really tense or exciting, both of those can be on that side, or 1. So you just hold up your fingers after I play a little opera sample, famous opera samples, and you can tell me if you feel really, really tense would be a 10, or really, really relaxed would be a 1. And there's no right or wrong answer, just so you know, because we all receive music differently. So let's see if I can find my files. My beautiful assistant. Okay, so I'm going to give them away this way. Oh, well, okay, we'll figure it out. I want to play for you first this. This is a lovely duet from Lockme. See if that worked. Volume up. A little bit of recitative. A I'm actually going to scoot ahead a little bit. See if I can do that. Perfect. Back to the top. So, level of tension from 1 to 10 on your fingers. So people are at like between 1 and 5 or 6 or 7. Okay, so we got a wide range in here. There's a little bit of excitement there, but it's not huge. We're not like bowling over the top. Let's try another famous moment. We're probably going to go back to this, but we'll see. Okay, you all know this, right? Right. We probably already have an idea of where we're going to be. And maybe, I mean, you know, like, ideally the volume would be way up on this one. I don't have to go too far into that. What's your rating? Okay, people are saying 10, 10, 10. Is anyone less than 10? Maybe that's an 11, right? All right, so the Valkyrie, they're flying off and they're taking souls to heaven and coming down for battle. This is Wagnerian opera that's tension, but it's excitement. It's not the worst kind of tension, right? It makes you have excitement. We'll talk a little bit about why in just a second. All right, let's try this one, which I don't know how many of you know Pierrot Lunaire. Let's try this. Maybe down a little. We're going to stop that. Tension level, emotional tension level inside yourself. Okay, interesting. It's surprisingly often less than the Wagner. Ah, that's interesting. Okay. That is Pierrot Lunaire by Arnold Schoenberg, composed about 100 years ago. Does anyone know what it's about, what Pierrot Lunaire is about? It's a clown. Does that bump up the scary level just a little? Okay, maybe a little bit. Okay, so what we're looking at here are composers' techniques for creating tension and relaxation. And what we have in music is a series of rules that we learn when we're in music school from the first year on, and they start with Bach. Everything always seems to start with Bach. My friend Holly Mulcahy, who is in the Grand Teton Orchestra, says that Bach is like a glazed donut. That is where you start, and then you move on after that. So with Bach, we learn things called voice leading, how to make a beautiful melody. And in this last example, the Pierrot, that's not really a beautiful melody. She's schwarzenegg and oh da 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 da. Right? That's not really what we're used to in a melody. And the Wagner example with the Valkyries, da 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 da, that is a melody, but it's not exactly a beautiful voice leading. It's a horn call. It's a hunting call, obviously, right? With those kind of intervals. And then we started with the lakme, the beautiful duet, the flower duet. That is absolutely beautiful voice leading. The singers aren't leaping anywhere, and when they do leap somewhere, it's for an emotional push. And so you can see that voice leading and how you create a melody creates relaxation or tension. So that's the first element of these traditional rules that we learn in music school. Another element is harmony. And so basically we learn what chords follow what chords in a really complicated flow chart. That's kind of how music works, is we go from a one chord, which is whatever the name of the key is. So if we're in the key of C, that's a C is a one chord. And then we end up eventually going to a five chord. A five chord would be G, so C, D, E, F, G. And then we go back to a one chord. And that is, in a way, a narrative of all classical music. It gets messed with here and there, but the idea of home, away from home, and home tends to be the underlying narrative of almost all classical music. And when you don't get that narrative, you feel a little upset. You feel a little tension. I'm going to play you an example. And if you were here this summer and you heard me give a talk, I like to use Carmen because it's such a beautiful example. We're going to listen to Carmen and the narratives within Carmen by using the overture to Carmen. Can everyone hear me, by the way? Am I doing okay? All right. So the overture to Carmen, I'm going to talk over it a little bit, so we'll see how the volume goes here. All right. Very martial. This is soldiers. And we see that the beat is regular, and it's a hummable melody. Matter of fact, Emmy's walking in marching, right? Okay, now let's move on. I'm going to squish us forward. Okay, next. This is the March of the Toreadors. Lovely, good voice leading. Harmonic rules are being followed. So everything's good. It's a little less, you know, boomy and marchy. All right. Now what this does to be a slightly exotic and different than the march is it extends the phrase. We're used to four-bar phrases. I'll get to the top of one. One, two, three, four, two. Three, two, three. Now we expect something new. Three, four, two, three, four, three, two, three, four, four, two, three, four, two. Wait a minute, that was a seven-bar phrase. And now we're back to the four-bar phrases. Let's go back over that for a second. So we like a four-bar phrase. Ever since Bach, we've gotten used to hearing phrases that are tightly in four or eight, maybe two. It feels good. You kind of predict where the music goes if you're listening to regular classical music. It's comforting to us. And so in the case of these toreadors, the phrase becomes seven bars instead of eight. So there's this tiny little subtle exoticism in your head when you're learning about the Spanish in this opera, right? It's a French opera set in Spain from the 19th century. But he's playing with the regularity of the soldiers versus the exoticism, those extended phrases of the romantic Spanish, according to, you know, 1875 France. So let's keep listening, and then I'll point out where Carmen comes in. There she is. What's the tempo? I have no idea. That's a dire chord. There's a two-bar phrase. Okay, a two-bar phrase again, but in a different key. We've changed up the flow chart. Here's another phrase. Oh, but we're extending it now again. Where are we? I've lost my sense of timing in the world. Okay, one more time. But it's a new key, a new level. Two bars. Two, three, two. Okay, change the key again. Three, two. Oh, we're extending this phrase. Three. That wasn't a two-bar phrase. Okay, we're still okay. We're four. Phew. Two, three, two. Change it. We're getting faster. Two, three, one. One bar phrase. Oh God, what are we gonna do? And then listen to this. That was not following the rules. That is a chord we're not allowed to have at the end of a whole section. It leaves us filled with tension. So on a psychological level, we haven't even met Carmen yet. This is just the overture. We have tension at the very end of it, and something must be resolved. Now, the traditional way that opera resolves things is to kill the lady, right? This is usually what happens, and in the case of Carmen, the same thing happens. But the narrative of Carmen that is told through the music alone, not even the words, is that things are all right, normal, and in their places. That's the military in the beginning. We get a little bit of crazy exoticism, but it's still contained. And then Carmen comes in and throws everything off. Because if you know the story of Carmen, everybody falls in love with her, everybody wants to have her, she wants no one, she's constantly breaking the rules. And in the very end, the only way we get to harmonically resolve her is to give a nice big fanfarish cadence when she's getting stabbed. Right? And so it's weird because you're watching Carmen and you're feeling maybe sad for her. We might be looking at her with modern eyes that, you know, oh, she's this great free woman, but we have to resolve her with death. And so you feel a relaxation on a musical level that sends this kind of unpleasant message about Carmen, is that we have to kill this aberration. So what I wanted to do in Locust was change that narrative a little bit. And so what I ended up doing was thinking about the characters, these beautiful characters that Jeff Lockwood has written. She is the personification of an already dead species, the Rocky Mountain locust. And she comes back as an apparition, as a ghost. She's already gone. She's already resolved in my head. And so for her, I wrote the most beautiful music I could imagine to try to dispel the idea that this ugly swarm of locusts, yeah, they were problematic in the 1870s, but we lost a huge species. This massive species that just the physical mass of it alone enriched our soil, let alone, you know, that terrible loss of a whole species. And so the idea was to make her beautiful and already resolved and settled and without tension. So for the locust, I tried my best to create the most beautiful, lush, French 19th century sound. And I didn't even realize I was doing that until I talked to the soprano, the French part. And the soprano said to me, "It's interesting because I feel like I'm in 1906 France." And I realized, oh, that's when the locust died. I reined her in to that time period. I put her back there. So you'll forgive me, this is not a professional recording. We just got this recording yesterday, and it's not polished. This was a rehearsal recording. But I'm going to give you a sense of the locust coming in. Well, it's not quite coming in, but... she's talking about being frozen in the glaciers. An elegant waltz, melodic voice leading that is very, very linear. And regular phrases, beautiful bells, sparkles representing the swarm. Okay, just a little sample of her music that shows where I was trying to go with her without the tension. in a way, Jeff and I were talking about this, in a way, we've sort of created a strange feminist opera, if you think about it, because she doesn't need resolution like nearly every other heroine throughout history. The person who needs resolution is the scientist, because the scientist is desperate to solve this murder mystery. He's desperate to figure out what happened to the locust. How did they die? And so his music comes out with odd length phrases. The meter, the pulse of the thing, isn't even. I often do a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the beats are not the same length. They're short, one's longer and one's shorter. The phrases are odd. His music is jumpy, like a grasshopper. I've got my little grasshopper necklace here. So everything about the scientist puts him into interruption land and often tension. The whole shape of the opera is some introduction and relaxation, a whole lot of tension because the scientist is being haunted and trying to figure things out and getting interrupted all the time, and then some relaxation at the end when we finally realize what happened. So let's listen to a little scientist music. This is called "The Storm Has Cut the Power," in which he's coming up with a theory that perhaps flame, because he has to light a candle, perhaps flame is what caused the end of the locust. Hear all those jumps and all the chromaticism that leads around. It's not very melodic. And a lot of percussion. Okay, so that's just one sample of some of his tension, some of the percussion that's involved. You'll notice that he has a little bit of a drinking problem. And so I've incorporated bottles as musical instruments in the score to sort of represent his drinking issues. All right, and then the third character is the rancher. And the rancher is connected to Earth, very clear about his desires. He wants the grasshopper problem solved, and he's very sentimental about the land and about his job. And so while his intent is not to eradicate a species, he wants his own problem solved, and so he's not thinking in the bigger picture, I think. So to represent this, I used some hymns. I put some hymn music in there. I created a sort of somewhat religious feeling for his music. It's clean, it's simple, it's beautiful. And the hymn, just so you know, is a Unitarian hymn called "How Beautiful Is the Earth." So we stuck a little secondary message in there with that tune. So let's listen to a little bit of the rancher. This is his aria where he sings about how his grandfather's farm was taken by locust earlier in the century and what his grandfather did about it. Oh wait, that's not it. Ah, yes, it is. "We Can Fight." Does it say that up there? I think I might. No. Sorry. Oh, it's a rehearsal. That's why. We've got some extra on there. Let's see if I got it. Hope my engineer didn't get me the wrong section. It looks like I got the wrong section here. Let's see. That's lots of, you can tell, that's grasshopper music. And, oh well, we got grasshopper music instead of the rancher. Sadly, okay. Well, you're gonna have to trust me that the rancher did some beautiful stuff. I apologize for that. The last thing that I want to show you is the narrative level of the overall piece and how I connected everything. there's an interest for me in showing that we're not that far apart from each other. So the rancher's desires, the scientist's desires, and the locust needs to be a species are all linked musically. So I'm going to play for you the overture where I show you all of these links. There are three sort of elements I'm going to point out. The first is something called a second, a musical second. That's where you have one note right against another note. It's often seen as wrong and needing to be resolved. But if you set it in the right way, it can be a beautiful thing. And so whenever you hear the jumpy music, I've set it in a more agitating way. And when you hear the rancher singing the hymn, I've set it in a church-like way. And when you hear the locust, I've set it in a beautiful way. And so there's always these really close notes hanging out together in this music. So let's listen for the seconds in the overture. Not Carmen, but mine. Called The Prairie. There's one. Strings, and that AG right there is a second separated instead of together. But I don't know if you can hear the closeness. I'm always putting them together. Rehearsal tape. There's two notes together in the piano. Here's the second. Those notes are together, and then they separate. Okay. So that closeness of notes representing our connection. And then what you just heard at the end there, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba, that comes back over and over again as the theme of the locust. It's a chord that's spelled out. It should be just a normal chord, but I throw a second at the end of it. So when you have a chord, you should have notes that are separated from each other. And then if you put an added note in there, you're creating a cluster or a tone that implies needs resolution. So with that separated chord, I've included both the regular harmony and the closeness of the seconds. And that's encompassing them all, collecting them all together, creating a connection. That shows up often as the only accompaniment for the locust. She has the separated chord and it flows beautifully. Okay, so those are some things that happened there. I'm going to give you the other sort of quick levels of narrative and then I'll leave us some time to talk. The other levels of narrative include a little layer that I put in of play and joke for myself, because I'm living with this for so long. It was like 8 months of composing till 10 o'clock at night, and I had to give myself a little bit of entertainment. And so when I said I opened up the thing and those two notes that form the second are A and G, well, my name is Anne Guzzo. So I imprinted my stamp on the opening, and that those notes are very significant and those keys are very significant for the opera. So that's my own little personal stamp. Another little little funny moment and personal stamp for me was when I was composing the rancher's aria. There's a moment where right before where the scientist and the rancher are talking, and they're talking about the monarch and how the monarch can get into danger if it gets into a bottleneck and it only has that little valley up in Mexico to survive, and if that gets destroyed, the whole species goes. And so that conversation between the two of them, the rancher makes a parallel and says, oh, it's like a squeeze chute. That's a trap. They think they're safe, but then that ends up being the end of their life. So you have to be careful when you get into these squeeze chutes. And right before that happens, in order to cue the tenor, I used the notes B, E, E, and F over and over again. And that was, it has no significance other than it made me laugh when I was composing, and that's how I built that whole aria, was off of those pitches. And then the last level of narrative that I'm going to explain to you is that because I'm working with Jeff, who often writes these really great mystery novels, and this is a mystery opera, there's the idea of clues and red herrings. And so if you follow the bells, often the locust has a series of bells when she arrives or comes in. And the quality of the bell tells you whether you're hearing a truth or an untruth. So if you hear the very clear pitches of what's called the orchestra bells, that's clarity and truth. And then if you hear the very colorful and shiny and lots of different tones, then I'm sending you off, or Jeff is sending you off on a slight red herring. So if you just listen to the bells alone, you could probably like figure out the opera before the end. So that's the third level of narrative. And there's more things like that, but I think we don't have time to go through all of them, and I want to make sure that we have discussion time if anyone has any questions. So, questions or comments?
Also wrote liturgical music, and he told me once that he takes the, particularly with his liturgical music, he takes the words and adapts the music to words rather than vice versa. So I guess my question is, what a process. What comes first, the libretto or the music?
In this case, I really love to work with the words. So I like to have all the words done and then permission to mess them up. So that's, Jeff and I had an agreement that we could do that. So I love to have the words because the words suggest these things to me. So the idea of having a certain speech pattern for the and certain words for the rancher, he talks about being pious. Why has he got a plague of locusts? He's a pious man. And that, of course, immediately suggests a hymn to me, something liturgical, something that might represent his desire to be true and honest. And that's suggested a hymn. The locust often speaks in sort of almost poetic language, and it often implies dance, an elegant dance. And to me, a waltz is perhaps the most elegant dance. And so I often set her in three and give her a waltz. And it's just these little connections when I read that say, I bet that could be a waltz. I have no idea what the melody is going to be or the harmony. I just think, oh, a waltz. I need a beautiful, elegant waltz. And that was my first reading. Was going through the script looking for suggestions. I didn't always follow every single obvious suggestion on the page, but I tried very hard to create that. Yeah, so does that answer that? I mean, I've done it the other way, but I find it really hard to go backwards. That seems like backwards to me, to first write music and then try to fit words. Mm. There was a Renaissance argument about this, by the way. Then there were lots of scholars talking about, do the words come first or not? And they said the words came first. Yes?
Can you say a few words about how you choose the instruments to create the impression that you wish?
Yeah, that's a great question. It really matters. It changes. I considered a string quartet for a while in my head. Choosing the instruments is a matter of two things. One, I want an ensemble that sort of is already formed so that I'm not like trying to find a kazoo and a sarrusophone and a bass trombone. That's a weird ensemble. They don't usually meet together. But a string quartet, this particular ensemble is preformed often. I liked this one better than a string quartet because it gives me color. The colors of clarinet, flute, and percussion added to strings and piano. The other part of that is deciding which instrument goes with which character or helping to sort of develop the narrative that way. The only thing that I really did that way was to put bright bells and sparkly things with the locust. And part of that actually has to do with the costume designer, who you'll hear from next, was the idea that we wanted her costume to radiate light as if the swarm followed her wherever she went. And in the Wildlife Museum, they don't have professional theater lights, But we still, I think, got the effect of the sparkle. Yeah. Does that answer that? Yeah. And what was your question?
I wanted to tell you a few things that really worked for me. I really like your use of percussion. And I thought that added a contemporary touch, yeah. Especially because you had unusual sounds. Right. But he did a great job.
He did.
The second thing is, I liked the three elegiacs strands to the opera. Mm-hmm. The 19th century, they say, like,
right.
soprano, who seemed at first not to fit, and then I thought she was perfect. And then the second was Copeland-like to me. Yeah. The Prairie song was, especially the harmonics in that.
Yeah.
We're just very Copeland-like, and I wanted to do Rodale. And then I really like the liturgical touch. I thought that was really good. Yeah. So here's my silly question.
Okay.
When all the bottles fell over, was that part of the score?
That was live theater.
That was not supposed to, although in a way it makes sense because he does kind of get tanked, but no, it wasn't supposed to happen. That was just an accident. I'll ask him. Maybe. Yeah, no, the bottles are just being used as percussion instruments and not in a crash, and that was an accident. But I mean, like I said, it wasn't
well,
to it. It did. At least it wasn't in the middle of a lovely aria. Right, exactly. Yeah, that's just live theater. A couple of things happened. Yeah. Anyone else? Yes.
My question is, you mentioned at the outset that music conveys a certain narrative in our minds.
Yeah.
It's only for people who are born and raised in entirely different cultures,
yeah,
where the musical instruments are entirely different,
yeah,
not being exposed to the Western culture entirely.
Sure.
If they develop a listen to the narrative as ones that we would see in our minds?
Well, this is an excellent question, and there's much argument about this. I think that some of the things, in my opinion, and this is just my opinion because I'm not a scientist, and it's not, no one has defined this answer, but in my opinion, there are some things that are universal. So speed can often like raise your pulse rate, and there's a lot of studies, this is scientific, there's a lot of studies that drumming can change your pulse rate, either to calm you down or excite you. So the speed and the drumming and the pulse are things that I think are universal. There is also a kind of a scale called the pentatonic scale that is in every culture. There is no culture without the pentatonic scale. And so I think that can convey certain energy and motion and predictability, the calmness. You may have seen a video of Bobby McFerrin online where he gets an audience to sing and they sing the pentatonic scale without even knowing they're doing it, and he doesn't even teach them. He just says what note's next and they sing the pentatonic scale. And so that video suggests to me, and that whole experiment and the fact that ethnomusicologists have told us this scale is in every culture, that's one of them. And another one that I think is the natural overtone series. And so that's why a lot of people will argue that Western music is natural, although I think that's got a lot of problems. But one of the arguments is because when you play the overtone series, you get the 1 and the 5 first, which I was talking about at the beginning, as the basic flow chart of all Western music is 1 to 5 and back home. My guess is that there are lots of different ways that other cultures say the same things that we do, but in their own particular cultural language. So I do a lot of international dance. I do folk dance, and a lot of the Balkan ones really move me. And I know nothing about the harmony. I don't know why. But one of the things that I love is the closeness, and they have the closeness harmonies in Eastern European music. And that moves me, and I like staying with the closeness instead of separating it, which is what we do in Western music. So if I can be moved by other cultures I'm sure are moved by our music. There's a few universals, but I think really, to make it really work, it's your home, probably your native language, unless you're really schooled in the other non-native language. That's my guess. Any thoughts on that, or you wanna, yeah.
Who knows?
especially when the instruments are entirely different.
Yeah, yeah.
We're not exposed to it throughout the upbringing.
Right.
Could also a certain type of reaction, maybe different than ours.
Yeah. Yeah. I know nothing about music. I certainly know nothing about composing. So I'm enjoying this immensely. But it seems like you've done a lot of thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess my question is, how much do you sort of go with the inspiration? Because I always thought Mozart's was when they are
right.
Sort of a
right. Oh, here's the little band. Terribly sitting.
But
yeah.
I'm sort of hearing a lot of thought to each sort of phrase and what have you. So I'm just curious what their balance is.
The balance is interesting because I'd say it's probably 80% walking around with a coffee cup staring out a window or digging in my garden, and my brain is processing and I'm thinking. Maybe it's not 80%, but it's a fair amount, at least equal, where I'm processing. And just in my defense, that was Beethoven's methods. I'm no Mozart, that's for sure. I can't spin out a piece like that, or it's happened rarely in my life. The one piece in the opera that happened just where I just sat down and wrote it all was the Rancher's beautiful aria where he uses the hymn. I process a lot, I sketch a lot, I think about it a lot, and then finally at some point my brain is ready to start it. Then I sit down at the piano or at my desk and it comes out. It's kind of like it has to tell me when it's ready, and then it happens. I think it's similar to, a lot of you are probably creative, and it's similar to any creative process where you have to cogitate and go to bed thinking about the problem, and at some point you wake up with all the answers. Anybody else? Yes.
I'd like to come back to this general discussion about culture.
Yeah.
As I recall, Bernstein has a theory about universality of music or some aspects of music. For example, recollections, if you'll forgive me, it's da 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 da. He says that phrase is found in every culture.
Yeah, yeah.
In mind, would you comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, so between the overtone series, mothers and children, there's some theories that things are universal. And so the children's themes, na 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 na, and stuff like that, seems to be strangely universal. Children mock each other at the same pitches all over the world. and a lot of people suggest that it might be from crying, that vocalization and pulse, the mother's pulse, are two universals. And crying often goes down, right? And so that extra emotionalism of downward phrases, na na na, is a part of that natural cycle. The pitches, the sort of voice leading theories, the ideas, human voices, when they're not opera singers, you know, naturally sort of sing in one or two octaves. They don't have this huge range. And that limits it, and it's easier to hit those notes with your vocal cords, so those small intervals may be natural. Those are some of the ideas.
Can you give us some other examples?
Of things that are, let's see, pulse, and people think dance. Oh, musical examples of things that are universal, like melodies, you mean, or... The pentatonic scale, which goes da 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 da, a pentatonic scale in that sort of arrangement. Drones, so like a bagpipe has a drone, early chant has a drone, and lots of Middle Eastern music, the Tibetan monks have a drone. So the idea of one pitch that sort of holds us all together, and then you sing something on top of it. Yeah. One last question, I guess.
Had you written the opera already when you cast Kristen, or did you write this with her in mind?
I was writing while she was being hired, and as soon as I knew she was going to be our soprano and our director, I emailed her and said, what's your voice range? Where do you like to sing? Where do you not like to sing? What should I not do? What should I do? Because each voice is different. You can't just write for a generic soprano. you can, but then you may hit some of their bad spots. And honestly, I did hit a couple of her bad spots before I had her on board, and I was like, oh, dang it, but it wasn't worth changing it, because she did a great job. Thank you. Thank you all.